the Lightning Network. I'm sure this is a topic that you've heard mentioned multiple times over the past couple months, but how many people actually understand exactly what it is, how it works, why we need it, and what it means not just for Decred, but for the entire cryptocurrency ecosystem moving forward? You know, the Lightning Network is an incredibly important topic, and I want our community to be the most knowledgeable community out there, so I put together a special Lightning Network mini-series that dives into all of these topics and breaks them down into easy-to-understand pieces. So this video is part one of the mini-series and covers why do we need the Lightning Network. I hope you enjoy. Okay, before we talk about why we need the Lightning Network, let's first kind of just establish a high-level definition of what the Lightning Network is. So the Lightning Network is what's called a second-layer solution, meaning it runs on top of a pre-existing blockchain, and it allows the users of that blockchain to send transactions in a near-instant manner with very low confirmation fees and while storing a minimal amount of data on the blockchain itself. So it's a scaling solution, and it employs smart contracts to keep this process entirely trustless. So throughout this series, I'm going to be using Bitcoin as a primary example, and that's just because, you know, it's easiest to talk about Bitcoin. There's the most data available. The core Lightning Network development is being done on the Bitcoin blockchain and then ported over to these other cryptocurrencies. You know, but anything that we cover is applicable to any cryptocurrency that plans on adopting Lightning Network in the future. So just keep that in mind, you know, as we're going through this series. All right, so let's move on to Bitcoin's capacity problem. When you send a Bitcoin transaction, what you're doing is you're broadcasting your transaction to the rest of the Bitcoin network. It then gets added into a pool with all the other pending transactions called the mempool or the memory pool. Miners will grab transactions out of the mempool, compile them into blocks, and then they'll all compete to solve a computational puzzle. Whoever solves that puzzle first gets to add their block onto the blockchain, and they get a block reward, you know, for their services. Now, when they're choosing which transactions to pull out of the mempool, they're gonna choose whichever transactions have the highest transaction fee attached to them, and that's because the miners get to keep those transaction fees. So they're gonna grab as many transactions as they can to compile into a block. The thing that limits the number of transactions that they can pull out of the mempool is the block size limit. So Bitcoin has a fixed block size limit of 1 megabyte. So miners, when they're compiling blocks, are gonna grab as many transactions as they can until they hit that 1 megabyte limit. Now, according to a website called TradeBlock, over the past couple of years, the average size of a Bitcoin transaction has fluctuated, but, you know, historically has been about 500 bytes, which means that on average, Bitcoin has a transaction capacity of only 3.33 transactions per second. So this means that if more than 3.33 transactions are being sent per second, that the backlog in the mempool is gonna start to build up. And so miners are gonna continue to grab whichever transactions have the highest fees. And so people are going to, in order to jump to the front of the line in the mempool, they're gonna start increasing the transaction fee that they send with their transaction. So in this regard, the market sets the price of transaction fees. And, you know, as Bitcoin has been growing in popularity, there's been more and more and more transaction volume, which we actually saw in 2017 that started becoming a big problem, right? Transaction fees started spiking from $10 to $20 to $30 to $40, and they got very expensive very quickly, which ultimately is unsustainable. One thing that I want to point out is that 3.33 transactions per second number, that's a bit of an oversimplification. There are already techniques and technologies in use that increase that capacity number. You know, for example, if we look at a chart of the average Bitcoin block size over the past year, you'll notice that at one point, that block size trends above 1 megabyte, which, you know, you may be asking, how can that be possible? I thought Bitcoin had a 1 megabyte hard cap, and that's true. But that's made possible by Segwit. Segwit, we're not gonna get into the technical details or how it actually works, but for all practical purposes, that doubles Bitcoin's transaction capacity. If you're interested in reading how that actually works, I've included a link in the description to a blog post that goes all into the details of Segwit and how it actually does this without actually increasing the block size. So check it out. Another technique that can be used to increase Bitcoin's capacity is transaction batching. So transaction batching is where you send multiple people Bitcoin in a single transaction. So it allows you to essentially compress multiple transactions down into a single transaction. And again, let's just assume that that can be used to double Bitcoin's transaction capacity. I have no idea if that's realistic or not, but the main point is that it doesn't matter, because even if it did double Bitcoin's transaction capacity, we're still at only roughly 13 transactions per second, which is nowhere close to where we need to be. Like, we're not even in the right ballpark yet. If we want to be, or if we want to have a cryptocurrency that serves as a global payments network, you need to be able to handle hundreds of thousands of transactions per second. And so while these efficiencies and technologies like Segwit are nice and they definitely help right now, they help kind of ease some of the pressure, they're not the ultimate solution. So we need something more. So the question becomes, how can we increase Bitcoin's transaction capacity? And the obvious answer is to just increase the block size, right? If we increase the block size by 10x, then we increase the transaction capacity by 10x. But unfortunately, again, it's not that simple. Before we can get into the pros and cons of increasing the block size, we have to first have a discussion about full nodes and thin clients. So a Bitcoin node is simply a computer that is running the Bitcoin software in order to connect to the Bitcoin network. Bitcoin is a peer-to-peer network, meaning nodes talk directly to one another without having to go through any type of centralized servers. When someone says they're running a full node, meaning a fully validating node, it means that their Bitcoin software has downloaded at some point every single transaction that has ever been sent, and has manually verified, starting with the Genesis block, which is the first block of the blockchain, that every transaction adheres to the consensus rules and is in fact a valid transaction. So there are two types of full nodes that you need to know about: archival nodes and pruned nodes. An archival node is a full node that has a complete copy of the blockchain saved to its storage device. And so archival nodes can be used to help bootstrap new nodes. That just means sending new nodes all the data they need in order to get up to speed on where the current blockchain and network is at. And then they also help support thin clients, which we'll talk about in just one second. So the Bitcoin blockchain is currently around 160 gigabytes, which can be prohibitively large for a lot of people. And so if you want the benefits of running a full node without having to store the entire 160 gigs on your hard drive, you can run what's called a pruned node. And a pruned node will still download and validate every single transaction, starting with that very first transaction of the Genesis block. But once it's done validating the transaction, it doesn't store that transaction data on your hard drive. So you don't have the full copy of the blockchain saved to your computer, but you still have the benefit of having validated every transaction since the beginning of the network. And so Bitcoin software allows you to configure how much disk space you want to allocate to a pruned node with a minimum requirement of around 550 megabytes. As of March 2018, there are roughly 12,000 Bitcoin full nodes that are reachable and that are advertising their presence to the rest of the network. And that's what this image is that you're seeing. These are the locations of all the Bitcoin full nodes in the world. And this actually paints a pretty incomplete picture, because if you're running a Bitcoin full node, you have the option of keeping that node's presence hidden if you want to, which means that there are probably far more than 12,000 Bitcoin nodes running on hidden ports that we just can't see. Another method used to obtain transaction data is going to be using a thin client, also called a lightweight client or light client. And these thin clients allow you to access data from the Bitcoin network without having to download and verify the full blockchain. So a lot of times, if you're using a mobile wallet will be a thin client due to the storage and bandwidth constraints that you have on mobile. And the most popular method for that thin clients use is called simplified payment verification, or SPV for short. The way SPV works is it will connect to a Bitcoin full node. It will download the block headers for the full blockchain, which is only currently around 41 megabytes, so it's not a lot of data relative to the full blockchain. And then they download the transaction data for just the transactions that are relevant to the wallets that they control. And so one big distinction and one important point about SPV clients is that they don't actually, you know, they're not validating the consensus rules like full nodes are. And so this is an important distinction that we'll get into in a second. Full nodes are the backbone of a cryptocurrency network because they ensure that the proper consensus rules are being followed. They're also the only way to use Bitcoin or use Decred in a completely trustless manner, right? If you're validating that every transaction in the Bitcoin blockchain adheres to the correct consensus rules, and you can be 100% certain that no Bitcoins have ever been double spent. They've never been spent by somebody that was not their owner. They've never been created outside of the fixed inflation schedule, and none of the other rules required to keep the network running properly have been violated. Whereas if you're not running a full node, you're having to rely on trusted third parties. You know, doing something as simple as using a block explorer to check if a transaction has been confirmed means that you're trusting some person or company to give you that correct information. You're also probably leaking sensitive information about yourself that can be used to identify which wallet addresses you control. So full nodes ensure that the proper consensus rules are being followed, and they allow you to use Bitcoin or Decred in a completely trustless manner. Now, SPV clients are different, right? They're because they don't validate the full blockchain. They only care about the transactions that are in their wallets. And so the way they determine the validity of a block is they go off the number of confirmations that a block has. You know, if a block has 6 confirmations, then the SPV client can, you know, have a high level of confidence that the block is indeed valid. And so this is essentially outsourcing the verification process to the full node that the SPV client is connected to and to the miners. You know, the rationale is that, well, the full node validated the block and the miners continued to mine on top of it, so it's probably safe to assume that the block is valid. But this type of security model leaves SPV clients vulnerable to certain types of attacks. So one such attack would be a transaction withholding attack, right? There's nothing binding the full node from lying to the SPV client. So full nodes can easily hide transaction data from SPV clients. Now, an SPV client can, you know, minimize the chance of this happening by connecting to multiple full nodes and kind of cross-checking the data that they're receiving. But if you only have a handful of full nodes in the network, if you only have a small number, there's no guarantee that those full nodes are not colluding or that the SPV clients haven't been segmented off from the rest of the network. And so there's a risk there. An even more detrimental attack is what's called a chain hijacking attack. So if 51% of the miners are in collusion, they can potentially change the consensus rules without the SPV clients even knowing about it. You know, maybe they decide to increase their mining reward by 10x. So SPV clients blindly accept the blockchain that they know about with the most proof of work, which means that they would continue to follow the miners' malicious chain. And since they don't validate the consensus rules for themselves, you know, they don't even get the transaction data for the full blocks, they have no way of detecting the increased block reward that the miners are giving themselves. And so the way that this would play out in a network with a healthy number of decentralized full nodes is that it's unlikely this would even happen in the first place, because it would be very expensive and the miners' plot would be quickly discovered, right? The full nodes, the honest full nodes in the network would immediately reject the invalid blocks that the miners are trying to propagate to the rest of the network. And while the SPV clients would temporarily follow the malicious chain because it would have the most proof of work, at some point, those SPV clients are going to try and transact with those honest full nodes, which they used to be able to transact with, and now they're no longer able to transact with anymore, right? Because now they're on 2 separate chains, so that's going to set off some alarms. You know, the owners of the SPV clients are going to know something is up. And at that point, you know, the malicious miners can be dealt with accordingly. But if you think about a network that is made entirely of SPV clients, right, the risk reward for the miners completely changes, because if there aren't full nodes in the network to detect their consensus changes, then it becomes much more likely that they might be able to get away with something like increasing the block reward or increasing the inflation schedule. And the SPV clients would never even know anything is wrong or anything occurred. These are some of the attacks that SPV clients are vulnerable to. You have fabricating transactions, chain hijacking, and transaction withholding. And so, you know, in summary, full nodes are important because they make sure the rules of the network are being followed. They allow you to use the cryptocurrency in a completely trustless manner. Okay, so let's get back to the original topic of increasing the block size. Okay, let's first establish a ballpark estimate for the network capacity that we want to achieve. If cryptocurrency is going to replace credit card companies, at a minimum, they'll need to be able to operate at the same scale as credit card companies. So as of January 2017, Visa has processed a total of 141 billion transactions with a peak capacity of 65,000 transactions per second. So if we were to create a blockchain, an equivalent blockchain that already had 141 billion transactions in it and was able to handle a peak capacity of 65,000 transactions per second, that blockchain would already be roughly 35 terabytes in size, and the block size would have to be almost 10 gigabytes. And this is using an average transaction size of 250 bytes. So it's assuming a small transaction size, smaller than the current average transaction size is. So, you know, as you can see, running a full node for a blockchain of this size would be expensive from both a storage and a bandwidth perspective. You know, as costs increase, the number of people running full nodes will decrease. And as the number of full nodes decrease, the attacks that we just talked about in the previous section become easier to pull off and more likely to occur. So, you know, an argument can be made that if you're just trying to replace the credit card industry, you know, only having a small number of full nodes, it's not a big deal. You know, you can keep throughput high, fees low. But the problem that you're inevitably going to run into is that if you are truly a global payments cryptocurrency, you will surely be circumventing regulations in some country, right? And at some point down the road, you're going to need to be able to withstand a nation-state level attack. And not having a robust network of full nodes leaves the cryptocurrency vulnerable to attacks that target SPV clients like we just talked about. And so there's also this argument that you can increase the block size to some extent without negatively affecting the number of full nodes. And that's completely true. But this is a highly debated topic of, okay, how much should we increase the block size by and when should we implement that increase? And so, you know, there is a point where the block size increase will make it prohibitively expensive to run a full node. And that point comes well before the blockchain is able to reach Visa scale. So no matter what, we need to be talking about other types of scaling solutions. And that's what Lightning Network is. Lightning Network is a way to scale a blockchain by using off-chain and transactions in a trustless manner. Naval Ravikant sent a tweet out back in 2017 that said, "The winning store of value cryptocurrency will be the one that is the most decentralized." And that's because decentralization and security go hand in hand. But you can't think of decentralization as just a yes or no question. It's a multifaceted problem. You know, it's not just the decentralization of the miners. You have to take into account the decentralization of the developers, of the nodes, of the exchanges, and of the users. You know, centralization in any one of these areas comes with its own set of risks and trade-offs. A cryptocurrency can determine, you know, the level of decentralization that it needs by looking at its threat model. Cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and Decred need the highest level of decentralization because they aim to be global store value payment cryptocurrencies that will have to withstand attacks from the most sophisticated attackers in the world. You know, full nodes are part of this decentralization. So sacrificing the number of full nodes in order to increase the on-chain transaction capacity weakens the network and can leave the cryptocurrency vulnerable to attack. You know, to wrap everything together, we need the Lightning Network because we need a scaling solution that does not sacrifice decentralization, and on-chain scaling does not meet this requirement. You know, we need something more, and that's the beauty of the Lightning Network. It allows a blockchain to scale without having to sacrifice decentralization and while keeping the entire process trustless. So that wraps up part one. Stay tuned for part two, where we're going to dive into the Lightning Network, what it is, how it works, payment channels, onion routing, the risk of centralization, and the limitations. So thanks for joining us.